What's happening? This is Avedon, and welcome to another episode of the Beats for Breakfast podcast. Today, I am joined by my esteemed colleague, Mr. Rob Regal. What's going on, man? How you doing?
I'm over here chefing up my breakfast. Don't mind me. How you doing, man? How you
feeling? Chilling.
Rob Regal, DMV's finest, man. Appreciate the homie Avedon Smith bringing me through on this, man.
Man, yeah. Anytime, man. Thanks for coming through. Funny story. Rob and I actually knew each other before we had the names Rob Regal and Avedon. It's like, facts. We knew each other before. Totally, facts. Totally different aliases. Somehow, same group of friends, too, somehow. But,
yeah.
This is going to
be... He lived far.
Yeah.
He lives far, far away and still, like...
Somehow. Yeah. Like, you know what I'm saying? I went through the boonies of Maryland back up to Queens, and it's like, we're still bouncing off, like, each other's work. So,
yeah.
This dude had this joint. I found dude when he had this song called The Balance. And I was like... Yo, what song is this? I'm like, all right, this is tight. But the thing that I remember the most, this dude was at a flea market at the end of the video picking up, what is Zelda? I know it was Zelda, right?
Zelda and Double Dragon for the NES.
See,
what I do.
See,
I have them right here, literally right by me. Hold on, man.
I knew this was going
to... A few minutes later.
You hear me? This is what was at the end of the Balance video. You know what I'm saying?
This guy literally went and got the cartridges.
Right here. They're right here. Zelda.
This guy.
For $10. That's for both. Not $10 each. $10 for both.
That's a steal. Especially. Yeah. Wow. Okay.
Shout out to my Nigerians here in the DC area.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? Getting their hustle on at the flea market.
Hey,
they was like, I don't need this product.
How you do it, man.
I don't need this product no more. Who needs it? I said, me. I need it. And I happen to have $10 today because I was poor back then. So,
okay.
Came up, like, big pun. You hear me?
Well, that was probably the most different introduction that I probably will ever have in this podcast. So, I'm just going to ask formally, who is Rob Regal?
Man, Rob Regal is a young creative out of the DC, Maryland, Virginia metropolitan area, also known as the DMV. Born in Northeast DC, raised in PG County, Maryland. Lived in Philly for a little bit, lived in New York for a little bit, brought it back to Maryland. If you don't know me from rap, you know me from gaming. If you don't know me from gaming, you know me from rap. You know what I'm saying? Or you might know me because you was mad because your girlfriend liked me or something. I don't know.
Something of that nature.
It's a fact.
See now,
we're not going to do it.
But I'm not going to pivot the story time for that.
I've had some skirmishes, man. There's a lot of reasons you may know me, man. But
you're not going to dip into story time
you
for
know,
that.
If you don't know me from any of those, man, then you don't know me for real. So, you know, it is what it is.
Well, it's interesting because you're not just Rob Regal. As you mentioned, you talked about gaming, you talked about culture and everything. Mm-hmm. What inspired you to actually put gaming and culture into your actual name along with your brand? Because wherever you go, whether you're on the Chillcast or whether you start your stream, you said this is Rob Regal, gaming and culture. What really inspired that?
Just because I've always had interest in a lot of things. Like even my YouTube channel that I'm currently doing, right? When I first made it, it was like music videos for me. You know what I'm saying? It was my music videos, some vlogs, things of that nature. And then I turned it into a mobile tech channel. I was doing reviews on like the LG V20, the LG G6, the iPhone 10, which, you know, iPhone X is what I call it, whatever. It's an X there, okay? X. just all these different types of mobile tech things. I'm passionate about mobile tech. Shout out to dudes like MKBHD, your average consumer, you know what I'm saying? Android Central, Android Authority. Flossie Carter, like there's a bunch of dudes that like I was really watching heavy for mobile tech, and I wanted to like dip into that. It's a real passion for me. Like I was the guy who was with T-Mobile Jump, and not just Jump, but the Jump Plus joint, where you could just go ahead and upgrade your phone 3 times a year, whatever, or whenever you felt like it. Like I really like always had to have the latest phone, wanted to try the different tech in the phone, both Android and iPhone, and then I kind of like fell in love, not fell in love with gaming because I've always been in love with gaming, but I fell in love with learning how to create content for gaming, which was a lot of streaming, a lot of making videos and talking about gaming, because just like that, just like I am with mobile tech, I am with gaming. I'm subscribed to people like The Completionist, people like Berlizzi, people like Corey Kenshin, people like I can't remember their name right when I need to say it. The whole Normal Boots crew, you know what I'm saying? Satchel Drakes, people like what's cuz name? Damn, I'm trying to remember that. He's like my favorite one, but he's not the most popular one. Matt Visual. One of my favorites, you know what I'm saying? Like, there's people I've always been into watching. Game Grumps. You know, just a lot. A lot of always watching gaming content. And I was just like, man, I've always loved video games since a kid. Now I have the tools to go ahead and try to make some content. Let me go ahead and do it. And that's what happened. Went ahead, got a mic, got a capture card, got a webcam. And here I am. People apparently like watching me say stupid stuff on stream while I play video games over on Mixer. And that's just what I am, man.
Well, shoot.
Mixing the game and the culture is just giving everything that I care about. Like, you might come here because the main focus is gaming, but I'm also going to talk about other things. Like, when you see my video telling why Beanie Siegel's Mac Man is the greatest video game rap song that ever exists, I talk about how he makes the references in the song with Pac-Man and other classic video games, but making it to a street aspect. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's the mixing of the game and the culture, because I am all of these things at once. I'm not just some your average gamer dude who hates everything in gaming, but wants to critique everything in gaming, but wants to play every game, but doesn't want anybody to argue with me. You know who I'm talking about, Avatar. Those people exist. I'm not them.
No comment.
I have no comment on that.
That's all I'm gonna say.
Man, like, I'm a regular dude, man. I can sit here on stream for hours and kick it with y'all. I can go out to the hood, the most hoodest of hoods in DC, Maryland, New York, Philly, and kick it with them. Like, I'm really like that type of person. My gaming and culture is what it is. It's really gaming and culture.
Well, first off, you wasn't lying about the phones, because this boy, this man here, got me he didn't get me. He put me on to the Samsung S10.
Yep.
And he was like, I was looking through phones. I hit Rob up. I knew he was educated with phones. I was like, yo, all right, should I get the LG? I remember this conversation. Should I get the G7 or the LG the V30, right, at the time?
V30 Plus.
You want V30 Plus. Or should I cop the Samsung 9? And or should I get the Samsung Note 4? He was like, yo, you should just wait for the Samsung S10. It's just coming out about a week or so. When I looked at it, I was like, yo, this phone is official. So I hopped right on that right away, caught me the S10. And
he was definitely about to go get that LG, and I was you're gonna regret it. I owned the LG V30 Plus for a month, did a review on it. I'm just like, it's a cool phone, but it ain't Galaxy level.
This phone ain't
iPhone level.
This phone is on a different level. If you don't have that Samsung S10, if you need a camera to do like real creative content, like for YouTube, whatever, this is your phone.
Man, Bamas don't get that. They don't understand that. Like, they don't understand Android cameras is really vicious like that.
You know? Like, the front camera on this, you could record like real content on the front camera with this. It's really cool. Yeah. And the back camera is ridiculous. You can shoot movies on that phone.
Facts. Big facts. People are doing that.
Exactly.
People are literally doing that. Like, people don't realize Android cameras are really like that much quality, because they look at stuff. They're like, when I look at Android on Snapchat, it looks all blurry. And I'm like, well, that has nothing to do with the quality of the camera. It's it's the app. They never optimize Snapchat for Android unless you're using a Google Pixel phone.
They
went ahead and accessed the code to optimize it for Google Pixel phones. But that's it.
You know, for I didn't mean to interrupt.
No, you're good. You're good.
I wanted to say you're right about that, because I thought about that immediately. It's the same thing with Twitter. It's the same thing with almost any app. They optimize all the apps with all the apps for iPhone first, which is bizarre to me. I guess it's easier to develop. That's my only guess. Okay.
Yeah, I was about to say it's the easiest way to do it, because all iPhones use the same version of or variants of the same version of iOS. Basically, iOS pretty much stacks on top of each other when they do updates, and they just make small changes between them, stuff that doesn't completely break the continuity of it. So that's why it's easier to develop for iPhone. Android, you know what I'm saying, because there's so many people: Samsung, LG, HTC, Huawei, whoever it may be, Google, whoever's making the phone. They're all built different ways, and the optimization would have to be different for each one. And most developers don't want to go through that. So Android gets the short end of the stick of that. But what happens is, for the other apps, like the Twitter apps, the third-party Twitter apps, well, even the main Twitter app, a lot of these apps end up getting more features than the iPhone one, because iOS is more restrictive, because they all have the same continuity. So they'll take experiments and risk on putting some cool stuff on the Android versions of apps first, and then not on iPhone. That's why I say, like, I like iPhone and Android for different reasons. Like, I like iPhone because it's easy to pick up, use. Everything's gonna pretty much work flawlessly when I do it. But I like Android because I can start trying different things and getting access to more experimental features and things of that nature on there first. So that's how you pick. You know, whatever you want to use, that's how you're going to grade it for. Like, if you're smart and you want to get the best buck for your money, if you want to really have access to different type of features, go Android. If you want to be able to pick up, use with ease, and make sure it's not going to have any issues for real, go iPhone. And honestly, even that whole bar is very, very close now, because Android has become so optimized within the past 3 versions of Android. I'm rambling at this point, but I'm trying to tell y'all something so y'all don't waste y'all money. That's all I'm doing.
Hey, listen. It's not rambling, because there's some people, if they watch this video, you never know. Someone's probably trying to get a new phone. Like, you. In fact, we're going into December, so this is actually perfect time to have this conversation. Because literally right at the tax season, a lot of people are going to be looking at which new phones to get. So.
It's a
good move. It's good. But let's, you know, as you said, you already touched on it. You know, people, they know you either from rap, they know you from gaming. And, you know, previously you was, you know, formerly known as Lyricist, right?
I was known as
people who know me as N.I. Harris Skill. We're not gonna get into the definition of that name at all. That's another conversation. But
talk about it.
It's crazy, because we had an opportunity to really be more so in the underground, and in some cases, you know, more mainstream. You more than myself, but more so it's like we had people from industry eyes have eyes on our work. So I wanted to ask your opinion, because you've had a place where you performed on stage for at one point over 2,000 people.
Right.
And now you've even, ironically, now that I'm thinking about it, you even had streams of over 2,000 people. So my question to you is, what are the contrasts? Like, what are the differences, and what are some of the similarities between being an entertainer on stage and one that streams video games?
The same thing comes as far as the mentality you should have, which is, no matter if you got one person watching you or 2,000 people watching you, you got to give the same show. Not as in the sense of doing the same thing over and over, but just giving the same effort, giving the same energy to every single person that's watching you. You go out there on stage and think, oh, there's only one person in the crowd, I'm gonna just BS with this performance. You never know if that one person could be connected to the person that can end up bringing you a lot of money. That you can have a crowd of nobody out there, but that one person could be the link to really progressing your career. and you never know if you being on stream, you got one person watching you. You're thinking, oh, nobody mess with me. I'm just going to sit here real quiet and play my game and not interact with them in the chat. And for all you know, that person could be a representative from Streamlabs or from, you know what I'm saying, any of these companies that sponsor streamers, you know what I'm saying, or looking for the next talent. Because a lot of people think of streaming and they think only in the sense of like esports, you know, like people playing Apex or Fortnite or COD or whatever they may be playing and just trying to be competitive. They completely forget about the fact that one of the biggest sects of streamers are personality streamers. So if you're sitting there playing your game and you don't have a personality, you're kind of shooting yourself in the foot. You're looking at, you know, how many people are watching you and not giving as much effort and not realizing somebody could be watching you that could help open up the doors for you even more. You never know who's going to come into your stream. So that's very similar in that sense. I mean, of course, it's different when you're performing with rap, because when you're rapping, you're running across the stage. You got to deal with a lot more breath control, a lot more sweat, a lot more trying to remember lyrics and things of that nature. While when you're streaming, it's more so trying to make sure that you stay active with the chat while also focusing on the game, trying to find topics to talk about, trying to crack jokes, managing your stream, because every streamer I know done had that moment streaming and then your OBS is encoding overloaded. You know what I'm saying? Like,
you gotta manage the chat if you don't have your mods in there.
Yeah, if you ain't got no mods in there at the moment and somebody comes, starts putting racial slurs in your chat, you gotta manage that. Like, both of them, but I say both require multitasking. So that would be a similarity. You know what I'm saying? Both require multitasking. You gotta think on your feet, and you just gotta keep your energy up. So those are similar. They're very similar. And in both arenas of it, you're entertaining.
Yeah.
You have to be entertaining. I don't care if it's you're entertaining by getting wins or you're entertaining by engaging with your chat. You have to be entertaining in some form. You have to sit here before you go live and think, what makes me different from any other person that's streaming right now? What's going to make somebody want to come in my stream and stay there? What's going to make them want to hit that follow button? What's going to make them want to hit that host button? What's going to make them want to tell their friends to come check me out? Mm-hmm. That's what you have to figure out. And you have to do the same thing with music. You have to say, what's going to make me different from this rapper? What's going to make me different from this producer? What's going to make me different from this singer? What makes me stand out? Because everybody's doing it now. Just look at SoundCloud. Just look at Spotify playlists. You know what I'm saying? Look at AudioMac. Look at Bandcamp. Everybody's doing it now. The industry did not look like this 10 years ago. It was way harder to get in. Everybody can do it now because everybody can get a mic in their house. And not everybody sounds good. I mean, sometimes you get a Summer Walker, sometimes you get a Countess Vaughn. You never know what you're going to end up with. You know what I'm saying? So, yeah, that's just how the game goes. They're way more similar than different, though.
Got you. All right. Well, we're going to take a quick break, y'all. We're going to go ahead and you guys are going to get some commercials. We're going to see some of Rob Regal. Make sure you go ahead and check them out. And we'll be back in just a few.
Breakfast.
This is life when you're walking on the tight. Hey, look, leaning to the left, leaning to the right. My vision straight with the ending in my sight. They're giving me the world, just for giving them the talent. Mind over money, I'm just looking for the balance.
For the what?
Yeah, I'm just looking for the balance. Mind over money, I'm just looking for the balance. They're giving me the world, just for giving them the talent. Mind over money, I'm just looking for the balance. Hey, look, they wish I fall off just to drown in the deep end. I box me in, but I ain't Solid Snake creeping. Got about the lane of them average rappers. I can't be boxed, that shit's for cadavers. If my mind's complex, I'm stationed on the balcony. Golden thoughts with an iron heart, this is alchemy. Looking me over just made me go harder. Looking at these contracts made me a little smarter. Try to count me out the game, now I'm at the plate. And I'm out to get mine like a sex partner. Only trust people as far as you can throw them. Cause till you seen them fall, you can't really know them. Y'all bammers rap for the fame and your vanity. I would quit it all song for my daughter and my sanity. Pain brings wisdom, learn as you grow older. Was made cold-hearted by getting the cold shoulder. Keep to myself often, drama I hate such. I only hate people, we probably just don't relate much. My key strength just happens to be my passion. But now wearing your heart on your sleeves out of fashion. Mind of an addict, pain's the product from dealing with the mixed signals. I'm not surprised with the static. Trying to get the world just for giving them my talent. Mind over money, I'm just looking for the bad luck. Leaning to the left.
All right, welcome back. So we are going to dip right back more so into the music. Now, as I said, Rob Regal and myself, we were involved in the music industry. And on another day, I'll give my perspective on this. But today, I want Rob to give his instances and his experience with the music industry. And many people who sit in on the stands and on the background, they tend to think that the music industry is... it's almost like a circus. Like, everyone has their own opinions on the rappers, and they really, perception doesn't meet reality. A lot of the times, a lot of the people who you've seen joking around, especially back in the 90s, these were some of the probably the coldest hearted dudes out in the real. Like,
yeah.
Real talk. A lot of the music industry were full of real gangsters and real pimps back in the day. Let's just call it is what it is. Yeah, and we're talking about some of your older favorite rappers. I'm not even talking about now. Even now, some of them even put in work themselves. As silly as some people look right now, they still put in more work than you would probably ever imagine. So perception never meets reality. But in all, in the scheme of things, because now we have entered the age of the internet, and now, since record labels are now fading out and not having as of importance, I'm not gonna say not important, but they don't have as much power as they used to. What is some advice you could give to somebody who's trying to make it into the entertainment industry, not just music, but let's just broaden out into the entertainment industry in general?
Number one, make yourself the brand. Me and Avedon talk about this all the time. You do, make yourself the brand. The OG Kenny Burns, that's DC legend right there. Founder Studio 43. Legendary party promoter, now a member of Revolt, you know, Diddy's company Revolt. He's like one of the top dudes up there now. Lives in Atlanta now, has his own radio show down in Atlanta. You know, one of his quotes that always stuck with me was, you cannot promote a brand, you cannot sell a brand until you become the brand yourself. And that always stuck with me, because it's like, how can you expect to sell somebody something that you don't fully believe in? So you have to fully believe in yourself and make yourself the brand, and then you can try to move that, you know, forward. A lot of people come into music and they just think about being the best musician they can be. Oh, I'm going to be the best rapper, I'm going to be the best producer. And, you know, nobody cares. That's how the entertainment industry is. That's just the facts. Nobody cares if you're the best rapper. Nobody cares if you're the best producer. Nobody cares if you're the best streamer. Are you the most marketable streamer? Can somebody get a return back if they invest in you? That's what they want to know. And the best way to make sure that that works is to make sure that you are the brand that they're pushing, not an image, not a fake made up persona. Make the brand you, because then you can never get caught up in being inconsistent with that brand, because it's already you. That's the first thing I'd always tell people. Now, in the midst of making yourself that brand, make sure that brand is workable. Make sure that you are teachable. Make sure that you're somebody that can learn, you know what I'm saying, in the midst of being that brand. You don't know everything. I know you may think you know everything. You don't know everything. I promise you. I'm 31. I've been in the entertainment industry for 13 years at this point. I don't know everything. I know a lot. I know a lot more than most. I don't know everything. There's always something you can always learn. So make sure that you can take critique. Make sure you can take in a lesson if it comes to you. And don't base that lesson on who you're hearing it from. Don't base it on, I'm not going to listen to this lesson because it came from this guy over here and I don't really know who he is, but I'm going to listen to this lesson from Jay-Z because we all know who Jay-Z is. This guy over here may have been one of the people that helped Jay-Z level up, for all you know. Take your lessons and then judge it based on what you feel works for you. You know what I'm saying? Like, there's a lot of learning that comes with coming into the entertainment industry. Other than that, stay out the Bama stuff, man. And that's me putting it nice and edited for my homie Avedon. stay out the Bama stuff, man. Like, don't be going out here. I know some of y'all was lame before, like, you really became famous or whatever, right? Don't get famous and just be like, oh, I'm going to go ahead and start messing with women all crazy where the group is at, okay? Don't ever enter any business deal without looking at the contract. Don't ever downplay anybody you meet on the way up, because on your way down, you're going to see them again. Know that. It's going to happen. Treat everybody the right way, man. I know that fame can get to a lot of people's heads, but it can get, that gas can get deflated real fast, yeah. I've seen it happen. Like, it, in a, I can't say it's happened to me, because I always made a habit of treating people right on the way up, so people treat me right on the way down. But at the same time, like, I've seen it. And it's a horrible thing to see when it happens.
It's like Jay said in Lost One, it's like fame is the worst drug known to man. It's worse than heroin. When you look in the mirror like, here I am, still not see what you become. That's
fact.
And you know how I feel about Jay, but that, I still say to that line, it's like,
listen, Jay-Z is Avedon's favorite rapper.
Shut up.
I don't know if y'all realize that.
Shut up.
He did not take that moment to quote a Nas line at all. The first thing that came to his mind was a J line. You know why? Do you want to know why? Because Jay-Z has a line that applies to everything in your life, every moment.
That's the reason
why he's Jay-Z.
Listen. I give credit where credit is due, but I say that because to what you said, it's like the one thing, you know, like I said, Rob and I, we talk about being the brand all the time, because there's too many people who believe in making their product the brand instead of seeing themselves as the product. You think that just because I have what the people want, they're gonna come over to me. And it's sad to say, I've seen that done countless times. I've seen where people would want to do the same style of, you've seen it, people want to do the same style of music as what's popping, what's trending right now. And the funny part is, when the trend moves, so does the crowd. Then what? You're left high and dry.
If you're not talented, you're done. Look at Chingy.
Yeah, seriously. Or Jaquan.
I didn't laugh after saying it. I like Chingy's music.
It's sad.
Still, when the trend changed, that man was up out of here.
And look at
New York rappers.
Yo, look at the 2000s. Who in the people who were heavy and hot in the 2000s? You didn't hear about them in 2010, 11, New York rappers. 18. Yeah, you're right.
New York rappers. Like, honestly, New York.
That was G Unit. That was Dipset.
All of it.
Yeah.
And then the trend changed.
Terror Squad. You're right. Terror Squad. You had Dipset. You had G Unit.
Nobody wants to hear the New York sound. You know why? Because the trend changed from people wanting to hear people talk about shooting people all day.
Exactly. And people,
nobody wanted to hear that anymore. Like, people wanted to have fun.
And that's that. If we're very real, that started to change in the late 2000s, like 2008, 2009. You started to hear that differently, because it's around the same time Soulja Boy came out. And Waka Flocka. And then the music industry was slowly changing in that direction. And then the person who kind of led that ride, I would say, was Drake in like 2009, 2010, around the same time. He was doing a lot of freestyles. Like, I remember when he did the,
I don't know, man. It's not many things I give Drake credit for starting. I think
pioneered.
He did very well. I think that's what it was. I think he didn't start. I don't feel like Drake really started anything. I think what he did was he took things that already existed and just did them better than everybody else.
Okay, yeah.
He mastered. He didn't start.
There you go.
There was a whole topic about this author for New York Times who tried to say, like, Drake started singing on records. And it's just like,
No.
Like, Bone Thugs and Harmony existed.
Thank you.
Devin the Dude existed.
Thank you.
Like, there's a lot of singing that's been on records. And these aren't, like, artists that didn't succeed. Like, these are successful artists.
Yeah.
That were singing on records. Ja Rule existed.
Ja Rule. First of all, rest in peace. Nate Dogg existed.
Nate Dogg wasn't a rapper, but yes, Nate Dogg existed.
Like,
listen, there's a lot of it. There was a lot of it that existed.
Listen, man, what? Nate Dogg was almost like
sugar free.
See, I was gonna say Nate Dogg's kind of like Mike Tyson. It's like you don't ever say he wasn't rap. If he said he rapped on a song, you'd heard him. He's like, you like, all right, yeah, you rap, dog. Like you rap, dog.
I never heard Nate Dogg say he rap. He was very adamant about the fact that he sang. So,
but yeah,
sugar free rapped and sang.
He did.
Like there's, so it's always existed. I think Drake just found a way to make it palpable
exactly for
mainstream. And not just
and
these niche listeners.
I'm not saying that because I like Drake, but I noticed that he was doing something that a lot of the New York rappers were doing. He would actually like take old instrumentals mm-hmm. and rap over them. And the thing is, yeah, we are. And it was a thing that people.
No, why? Because buying beats was expensive.
Yeah, so people made whole mixtapes doing that. J. Cole was one of them. And Friday Night Lights is still legendary, but
the come up is still legendary.
It really
the warm up is still legendary. J. Cole got some classic mixtapes.
He really
Wale.
Does. Wale, of course.
Wale was rapping all over everybody else's beats. His first mixtape, Paint a Picture. He was doing that.
Shoot,
and fans don't even know about Paint a Picture.
I don't even actually.
Exactly. See, I'm gonna link you to Paint a Picture after we get done with this.
All right, cool. It's like, and I think. You know what? You're right, because Drake just found his way. He found a leg up, and because he had the association with Lil Wayne, I think that really like skyrocketed his career.
Yeah, because before that, he was just a mixtape dude. Comeback season, he was just rapping on everybody else's beats and ripping it, and pulled in a couple big features in the midst of that. And then when Wayne found him, that was just like, he's out of here. You know what I'm saying? Like, I don't think... As far as mixtapes go, there's maybe Drake so far gone, and Kid Cudi's a kid named Cudi. Those are probably the two biggest mixtapes. I mean, as far as if we're talking blog era, if you go back before that, then the G-Unit mixtapes, the 50 Cent mixtapes.
G-Unit,
those were
you had the G-Unit mixtapes. You had the Dipset mixtapes.
Yeah, but the Dipset mixtapes ain't have the impact that the G-Unit.
Because
and the Drake and the Kid Cudi ones. I'm talking about mixtapes that changed the culture.
I would say
Dipset was within the culture.
Yeah, they kept the culture going. Yeah, those are hood classics.
Yeah, they were hood classics. They carried on what G Unit started.
I'll give you that. You're right.
That's what I'm saying. Like they carried on what G Unit started. G Unit changed the industry as far as mixtapes completely. And then because before, yeah, think about it. Before 50 Cent G Unit, all mixtapes was like DJ Clue, DJ Envy, Funk Flex, all of them putting out mixtapes of a bunch of artists. Like the DJ was the star of the mixtapes. 50 Cent and G Unit made where the rapper was the star of the mixtape.
You're right, because
putting it out themselves.
But you know what though? I would say I can't give it only to G Unit. Let's be real. That was all Banks. Ooh. That was all Banks.
Nah, it was 50. It was 50.
50,
it
was 50. 50 was doing...
Well, 50.
50, okay. I'll say 50 this.
50 Cent is the Future was the mixtape that changed the entire
you know what? Structure you're right. of mixtapes. You're right.
Now, did you're right. Banks keep it going and hit even harder? Yes. But in that sense, Banks did exactly what Dipset did, which was keep the trend going once 50 Cent already changed the status quo.
See, Dipset, though, what I would say is Dipset had the most reach nobody ever knew about. Like, in terms of underground pull, it's like, they had Purple City Bird Gang, they had...
Yeah. SAS.
I was about to say SAS, Euro Gang. Yep. Euro Gang was another one, and speaking of which, those were some of my favorite sections of Dipset as well. Then you had... they started doing more collaborations with. They did a feature with Game. Young Money, because I remember it was
Wayne and Jewel supposed to put out the tape.
It was who else?
I Can't Feel My Face.
I remember that. I remember what song it was. It was Game. It was Jim Jones. It was Certified Gangsters. But it's like, it showed. It showed that Dipset literally was, like you said, they were more so hood, like focus on the more so the hood classics. But as you made a great point, 50 mm-hmm. Cent just changed the game for mixtapes in general, because that's what changed Lil Wayne to make mm-hmm. mixtapes in general. That's what made Manny Fresh the DJ Who Kid of where he was at.
Yeah.
And he was pushing out, you know, helping push out mixtapes for other people, because it was the rise of the South, really. So in that case, would you say that 50 Cent kind of like encouraged the rise of the South?
In a way, yes.
Okay.
In a way, yes. Again, when 50 Cent did it and it worked, it let artists know that they could do it. The South took advantage of that to the fullest. And the reason I pointed out, again, 50 Cent, Drake, Kid Cudi. And the only reason I'm saying Drake and Kid Cudi together, because both of those tapes dropped around the same time.
They did.
Both impacted the same way. What 50 Cent did with mixtapes was he made it where the artist could be the star of the mixtape, and you could put out your own product and make your own money off it and, you know, build your own fan base off it. What Drake and Cudi did was, hey, I'm going to put out this mixtape, and even though it's a mixtape, it's going to sound like an album.
Got it.
That's what they did. And that's where everybody kind of, the industry is still doing now, to the point where when somebody drops a mixtape, you don't even know whether to call it a mixtape, an album, an EP, or what, because it'll be a bunch of original songs and a bunch of original content,
right?
And no DJ, but here you go.
Here's my
album sounding mixtape.
You see, the reason why you say you're right, because now I'm even thinking about including Lupe in that, you know, because Lupe, the first and 15th album, mixtape, that was an album, that was a mixtape, but that sounded just like an album. You could technically call that his first album the way it is.
Yep.
Friday Night Lights for J. Cole, that sounded like more like an album than a mixtape. Yeah. So
now the problem was, and the reason I didn't even name them, because again, those came a couple years after So Far Gone.
Exactly.
And there, you know what I'm saying?
Exactly. Exactly.
And again, with it just sounded so much like an album, that was changing the tide. Because Wale was on the GQ cover with Drake and Cudi, but Wale's mixtape sounded like mixtapes intentionally, you know what I'm saying, being hosted by Nick Catch Dubs and Mark Ronson and all these type of people, like really hosting it and mixing it and blending it like a mixtape. And then Drake and Cudi was like, we're going to give you these albums that are mixtapes, but they're albums.
But so, then what I will say, what I did like about Wale did, he did for a moment made Go-Go mainstream with the Pretty Girls track.
Yeah. And multiple tracks, Pretty Girls, Bait, Clappers. There's a few. He finds a way. His first big local single, which is on the Paint a Picture mixtape, Dig Dug, was a Go-Go sample. And that was what blew him up in the area. Matter of fact, his first few singles was Go-Go sample. Dig Dug, One Thing About a Player, Breakdown, all Go-Go samples.
Yeah.
All of them. Like, he was in that pocket. And he was killing live shows with it outside of the DC area. Like, you know, Go-Go's always had a struggle with getting outside the DC area, because a lot of people can't understand the beauty of Go-Go until you experience it live.
Yeah.
Like, it doesn't translate to recording as well as house music or Baltimore
or Jersey Club.
Yeah. Like, it doesn't, because that's all computers. You can tweak it and master it as much as you want.
Go-Go is actually live
instrumentation, and it's hard to, unless you experience it in person and get to vibe with it in person, it's hard to like make it mainstream. And I'll keep it a bean, we're selfish. DC is selfish with Go-Go, no question. We are very protective of that, because that's our genre, and if you do it wrong, we're gonna feel a way about it, and you're gonna know we feel a way about it.
That's good.
And even outside of Wale, I mean, other you know, there's been other interpolations of Go-Go that have been used, and we respected and enjoyed it. Beyonce's Crazy in Love, that was Go-Go. People don't realize that. Nelly's Hot in Here, Go-Go. A. Marie's One Thing, Go-Go. Like, we've been, our producers like Chucky Thompson and Rich Harrison and people of that nature, they've been sneaking Go-Go into the industry for a minute. You can go back to Salt and Pepper and Kid and Play and, you know, hear Go-Go in the beats and stuff. Like, what's the joint? Rolling with Kid and Play, that's Go-Go.
Mm-hmm.
That's straight up Go-Go. Like, it doesn't get much more old school Go-Go than Rolling with Kid and Play. So, like, you know, it's just now it's finally starting to get to the point where people are appreciating Go-Go in its raw form. And it's dope. Like, what's happening to music is dope in general. We got all the way over. This is dope conversation where it gets to this point. Right? It feels natural. Like, yeah. It doesn't feel like it's rambling, but it's rambling. And that's a good thing.
Amen. It's like, people are enjoying this because it's like, you know, they don't necessarily hear myself talk about music on the gaming channel as much. And they don't hear about you talk about his music as much. It's like, more so, if you guys haven't noticed, there was a time where I listened to a lot of gangster rap and I listened to a lot of just regular rap in general, all types of rap. Like, rap and hip hop was a lot. But the reason why I like gangster rap is only because
he's from New York.
Shut up.
I'm sorry. When you're born in New York, you are genetically predisposed to enjoying gangster rap.
Listen.
I heard when you were born in New York, they give you a knife at your right next to your birth certificate. You take it home with you.
Listen.
You get a 9mm and you get a pair of Timberlands.
Listen. Your baby shoes, first of all, you got it all wrong. You get the baby Timbs, right? You do get the baby Timbs. All right. But the 9mm, man, it's just you can't hold that yet, man.
Okay, they say that to your 13th birthday, it's like a bar mitzvah. Okay,
exactly.
Shalom.
I listen to a lot of music, but we're gonna I have to actually ask, can we talk about interviews? So I have to ask you, because I've seen it on YouTube, and I'm pretty sure some people who already follow you, they already ran into this on YouTube as well. But for the people who don't know, people who are seeing you for the first time, for people who only see you in the Chillcast, how did you land the Sway in the Morning interview?
All right, so Sway in the Morning, and it wasn't even really an interview. It was a freestyle.
Freestyle, all right,
so what happened was XXL Magazine did an article about the 15 rappers that you need to know in the DMV. And I was in that 15 that they named. That came from me being on the blogs like Two Dope Boys, Complex, MTV News.
Shout out to Two Dope Boys, man.
Yeah, man. Like, all of them, me being on all those blogs and me having the relationships I had with bloggers and writers and such, pretty much got me on it. Because some of them people that was on that list got there because of connections. They got on there because they paid somebody or because they were connected to somebody like Kenny Burns or like Dre Hobson or whoever they may have been connected to at that time. You know what I'm saying? And that's not no hate. That's what somebody
that's the game
as a tastemaker is supposed to do for you.
Yeah.
I didn't have that. All I had was talent. And they did it based off of my talent, which I kind of wear on my chest with pride. Like, all the stuff that a lot of people paid to get done in this industry, I've always done off of talent alone. I couldn't pay to do this thing. I was poor. I was broke. I was destitute. So it wasn't going to happen, young. Right. So I did it strictly off of talent. And, you know, the name got put into that article. So when that article happened, it just so happened that Sway in the Morning was going to be doing the show in D.C. for that week. And they sent me an email and invited me to come on Sway in the Morning. Now, when I first got the email, I thought somebody was pranking me. I was like, who sent me this email? I'm hitting people up like, yo, which one of y'all sent me this fake email and stuff? You know what I'm saying? I'm cursing people out. And then, so I finally talked to the dude who ran the record label I was signed to at the time. He's like, yo, what name was on it? And I was like, says Kelly Kincaid. He's like, that's the program director for the show. Answer them back and tell them you'll be there. So I emailed them back. They let me know what day and what time to be there. I think it was like a Monday, 9 o'clock I need to be there. So I was there like Monday at like 8:30, 8:45. I got there early. I was nervous. I was going to have my brother film it, but my brother was out of town. So I had my man Matt come and film it, and we made a whole vlog out of it. And man, it was just one of the most amazing moments in my life, because I always dreamed, like, as a rapper, but like somebody that's a rapper's rapper like I am, to get on Sway in the Morning was like one of the greatest moments of my life. You know, we get there, we're sitting in the little green room. Most of the rappers that's there, I know them, you know, Uptown XO, Rada MC. I didn't know King Los, but I knew who King Los was. I didn't know Scar Akbar, but I knew who Scar Akbar was, because like I said, I'm like really like one of them dudes who be like chilling in the hood and stuff. So if you're from the DC area, you know about Aja Amani, which was a clothing line out here. I used to work at the Aja Amani shop, and Scar Akbar was real close with Marlon Clark, who ran the Aja Amani shop. So he used to have like DVDs of Scar Akbar up in Baltimore battling people, and King Los up in Baltimore battling people, and Chris Bars down here in PG battling people, and you know, stuff like that. So I knew who he was when I met him. And you know, we just all went in there, and when it came time for me to rap, I just blacked out. I remember that.
I saw you look like you blacked out.
Yeah, I don't remember nothing. I don't remember that. I think he said lyricist, I saw you on the Twitter, and I gave like this really fake laugh. I was like, ha ha, and I rapped. Because in my mind, I'm not listening to Sway right now.
I'm on Sway in the morning, but I'm not listening to Sway right now.
I'm not listening to Sway right now. I need to make sure that I get this freestyle off and I don't mess up at all. This is Sway in the Morning. Like, people have had their whole careers momentum ended by messing up on freestyling on Sway in the Morning. So
yeah,
I blacked out and I killed it. And then Sway was legitimately, and mind you, like, you see their reactions in the video. Sway's like, yo, yeah, King Los is behind me going crazy. First time ever meeting King Los, so he wasn't hyping me up like he knew me or something. He was just surprised at the bars I was spitting. And it's like, you know, he was genuinely impressed. And that's where you see the other video with him outside and him like co-signing me. Like, that was like one of the biggest honors I've ever had in my life. You know what I'm saying? Like, he genuinely meant that. I didn't make him say that. I was just like, hey, Sway, I'm doing this vlog. I'd be honored if you come and say something on there. He was like, no problem, man. After what you did in there, no problem. And everything from there, he said it. And that was just like, that was a really good look, man. That was a dream. That's literally a dream come true.
Nice.
Yeah, man.
Nice. So we're gonna take a quick one last break before we get into the last half, well, last portion of the podcast, and we're gonna come with you with another commercial break. Right back, y'all.
Up, baby, you got that off.
Beautiful Mind 3.
You got that off.
Right, man. There, that's
up. You got that off.
Good looking, Beautiful Mind 3. Say your name.
Yeah, man. Lyrics is PG County. I got his have nots in the loop. ZZ Gang. Yeah.
Yeah.
Balance coming soon.
All right.
Yeah.
Lyrics.
Yeah.
I saw you on the tweet.
Yeah. Okay, this is more than skill, it's my forte. Or say, I'm warming these mics up. This is rhyme full play, directing the pen, I am Scorsese. See, I always handle my B.I. in the fashion of B.I. But I'm packed with the content, spots never lost, they're like evidence of Big L side from the P.I. It's cliche to do a gun line about T.I., so I just stand tall like the socks reach knee high. I am the support, but niggas stay in the court, trying to strategize moves, but they never play the sport. So I'm something like the moat that's protecting the fort, or I'm November Breeze for niggas playing me short. Too cold, the new soul of a dying game. World joints, songs on point like Matt Ryan's aim. I bring pain like a lion dame. A's infected and still fucking over master of the crying game. It's two-sided. See, I grind and go hard, or I'm suave like the gel in the shower you massage. Get scalped, turn to war. See, I leak to the brain, so it's mental. Whenever I hit them instrumentals, crazy. Sketch dash, every time I wreck pads, Blackberry scripture, I ain't drink, this is X-Lax. Shitting when I spit it low, niggas need a wet nap. Niggas better bounce like Spalding on the check back. Spyro, fire, or I'm Cairo. Neck crack, cold shoulder like the failed senior who got let back. Dummy in the crash test, as yet, I ain't collided with no nobody. I'm colonic with the rap. Yes, you can put your shit out, then I'ma clean that shit up. As soon as they get out, it's time for me to get up. The fast cop and copper product waiting for the golden. So I link with everyday people, the coldest. We clothe them, it's over.
And we're back, guys. So we're gonna talk about gaming. It's somehow, some way, gaming has been something that both of us have been doing since we've been kids. And it's crazy because growing up, gaming is nothing like it is now. Like, if you wanted to play with your friends, it's like you had to have friends on the block, or your friends had to come visit you so you can hand them that work in NBA Jams. You can hand them that work in Mario Kart. You can hand them that work in GoldenEye. You know, you had to have friends come over to you. So if you guys wondering why I've been so competitive with video games, it's because I've been handing out L's and receiving L's in Street Fighter. Listen, friendships have been broken with the blue shell with Mario Kart. Friendships have been broken with the golden gun from GoldenEye. So
or using odd job.
Yeah, odd job with the knife. So, you know what? I'll take it back. Friends have been broken by using Goldberg in Revenge. So it's like friendships have been broken, and then they've been formed up again when they get their comebacks with you. But needless to say, I've grew up playing video games from a little bit in the NES era, but more so the Genesis, Super NES, all the way to the N64. Era.
Definitely yes for me. As you can see by the bag that I got those out of. Look, here's the whole bag.
You got the whole... See, this guy got the whole bag.
This is the whole bag of my... This is just NES games.
You see, all right, here's the thing. My brother owned the NES, and I think at one point, I think it just wasn't working at one point, so we only had Genesis. So the games that we were playing were like Street... I've been playing Street Fighter when... They just introduced Cammy, Fei Long, T-Hawk, and who was the last one? It was T-Hawk, Cammy, Fei Long, and DJ. Mm-hmm. Like, when they just introduced those characters for the first time, that's how long I've been playing Street Fighter. So if you could do your history, you could see I've been playing Street Fighter for well over 20 years. That's one of my favorite fighting games. But it's funny because... Looking back at gaming, I have to say, those are some of my greatest childhood moments. But I'm going to ask you, what were some of your favorite childhood memories playing video games?
Oh, man. Mine are always based around family. So, like, the first time I heard the intro music for Fat Xanadu, but I know it's supposed to be for Xanadu for the NES.
Okay.
Just even right now, having that song stuck in my head is like, the soundtrack to that game in general is amazing. I'll share with you after the podcast some of my favorite NES, some of my favorite parts of that soundtrack specifically.
Okay.
But the soundtrack to that, the first time I played Chrono Trigger on Super Nintendo, which was life changing for me, is still my favorite video game of all time to this day. Playing Final Fantasy Mystic Quest with my family.
Wow.
Such a horrible game. It's so bad. But we have so we got it from KB Toy Store, right?
Yo. And
the first time we got it. Yeah, you remember KB. the first time we got it, when you got to the little ice cavern joint, the game would glitch and break down. And you had to start all the way from the beginning again.
Sounds about right.
So we had to go turn it in and get another copy. And then it happened again at the same spot with the new copy. And it was just like, you know what? This game's broken. So I said, let me get Indiana Jones Adventures. Indiana Jones Greatest Hit, something like that. Whatever that joint was.
I think it was Indiana Jones Adventures, like you just said.
Yeah. Got that for the SNES. And then when you get about three stages on that, it glitches and breaks down. I was just like, yo, stuff like this is like why I love my childhood video game memories. Now, if we go back more than that, playing Terminator 2 Chess. on PC.
Where you, it was you like was a, you was different.
Yeah, because here's the thing: when you played chess in Terminator 2 chess, right? Like, so all the characters, all the pieces was like characters from Terminator 2, and when you took out another piece, it showed them like killing that piece. So like it had the Terminator, the little silver one, he would cut somebody in half and blood would split everywhere and stuff. Like that joint was vicious. Playing Indiana Jones and the Fate of Atlantis on PC, which is still one of my favorite PC games of all time. I went and rebought it on Steam and everything. Point and click type joint, you know what I'm saying? LucasArts. What else are some of my favorites? The day I got my Nintendo 64, the Christmas of 1996 during the blizzard. Listen, the blizzard hit the area, and we got that Nintendo 64 with Super Mario 64, and we got Donkey Kong Country 3 for the SNES that same day, and we got a new TV down in the basement, and it was bigger than all the other jumps. Oh, I mean, listen. I don't go to sleep. Well, back then, I didn't go to sleep on Christmas anyway. If I did, I went to sleep for a few hours, and we woke up like 5 a.m., 6 a.m. And that's how we found out about the TV, because we couldn't fall back asleep. So we were just like, we can't wake them up till like 7 or 8, till the sun come up at least a little bit. So, like, we can't open no gifts. Let's just go downstairs and watch TV. And when I said to go watch TV, the new TV was already hooked up and just chilling there. So we watching Rocky and Bullwinkle. You know what I'm saying? On Channel 5. You hear me?
Throwback.
Yeah, Rocky and Bullwinkle. You know about it. I used to show the cartoon version of Rocky and Bullwinkle in Georgia the Jungle in the early morning on Saturdays, because that Christmas just happened to be on a Saturday. And that's what we did. We watched that till my parents woke up. And then we went ahead and started opening up our gifts. And it was a Super Nintendo. I mean, sorry, it was a Nintendo 64. And the whole game changed at that point, because now I can play Mario in 3D. It's real.
That was a game changer for like a lot of people.
That was a whole game changer, man. Like, there's so many. If I really had to sit down, seeing my older brother play Final Fantasy VII for the first time, I didn't even know that Bama had a PlayStation. Where'd he get a PlayStation from? Which I later found out we got because this Bama took Chrono Trigger, Legend of Zelda, Link to the Past, and a bunch of our other really good and Super Nintendo games, and took them to GameStop, EB Games at that time, turned them in for credit to get a PS1 and play and Final Fantasy VII. Didn't even ask us. I had so many video game memories, so many tied video games. Going across the street to our friend's house, Brian and Angela. Shout out to Brian and Angela from Brentwood, Maryland. I don't remember your last name, but find y'all, or y'all see this, holla at me, because y'all was the homies. We used to go over there and play Revenge, or we play what else we used to play? We play GoldenEye, we play sometimes we play Sega Genesis. So I'll be over there playing what was that joint with the little the guy who was made out of like the, this is gonna sound horrible when I say it,
with the green man.
Yeah,
Vector Man.
Vector Man. I didn't want to say he was made out of balls, but
yeah. When you said made out, you said it's like where you had trouble describing him. I just felt like, did he talk about Vector Man? And I figured Vector as much. Man. Got it. Vector
Man, because he had the Genesis too. He had the N64 and the Genesis.
Yeah.
And yeah, man. And that man was made out of balls. It was really weird.
Very weird game. Fun. A very fun game, but weird nonetheless.
Yeah, man. Nah, I just have so many memories tied to video games, man. Video games have really been a part of my life longer than any other aspect of the culture. Like, longer than hip-hop, longer than mobile tech, longer than go-go. Like, I was playing Mario on the NES when I was 2. Like, and playing it. Not just, oh, I'm running off the edge and dying. Like, I was playing the games, for real. So, that was... You know, because when you got parents that always got to work, like, and you're a kid, like, what are you going to do? You're too young to run the block. You're not just going to sit around the house all day. All I did was read. That's why I had a fifth grade reading level in kindergarten.
Nice.
Yeah. Like, I ain't had nothing else to do. I'm going to read books and play video games. That was it. So that was my first thing that I really got into.
So let me ask you this, because you mentioned Chrono Trigger a few times. How did that become your favorite RPG?
It was number one. It was introduced to me when I was young. I was what? When did Chrono Trigger come out? 95.
Yeah, right now.
So I was 7. It was the first game I'd experienced that had such a expansive story, and I understood it. You know what I'm saying? Like, because we got the first Final Fantasy on NES, but I was too young to understand it when that, you know, when we got that. I was too young to get it. So Chrono Trigger was the first one where I was like playing this game that had a real story, because Final Fantasy Mystic Quest don't count. It don't count right. at all. Bam's name like Ben or something. Anyway, Bam was named the star of a Final Fantasy game being named Ben. Anyway, the point is, it was the first one I understood, man. The graphics were beautiful. Like, Chrono Trigger graphics are beautiful for the Super Nintendo. Like, they really used everything they had in the Super Nintendo to make Chrono Trigger. And just as I got older and started realizing, oh, there's all these multiple endings. There's all these little side quests that I didn't realize when I was younger. Just, I think it's the most perfectly made RPG to ever exist. And I challenge somebody to say, what game is made and packaged more perfectly than Chrono Trigger? Like, people can, you know, throw in the nostalgia for Final Fantasy VII, but it's not made better than Chrono Trigger.
I would raise up a game.
Let's hear this.
The only thing that I would raise up package, you said package wise, right?
Yeah, package, like as a total package.
I would challenge that, honestly, believe it or not. Even though, for personal, I love the Final Fantasy VII, but that's because of the franchise and the lore and the story behind it. Final Fantasy VII by itself, I was to remove that. I'm not going to say Final Fantasy IX. I'm not going to say a Final Fantasy game. I'm going to say Saga Frontier, still by Squaresoft. I feel like that's one of their RPGs by Squaresoft that no one really ever mentions. But the fact that you had seven...
Better than Chrono Trigger.
The fact that you had 7 different characters in different worlds that line up and link the way they did, I actually prefer...
Do you remember how many characters were in Chrono Trigger? Think about it. Count them if you need to.
Huh?
Think about it if you need to. 7. Say all their names if you need to.
No, it was like 7 characters, right?
Chrono.
Marley.
Marley.
Luca.
Frog.
I'm about to say Frog with the sword.
Ayla. Robo.
I was about to say Robo. Come on. And
some
character.
Magus.
Magus was on your team for a while. You're right. 7. So, okay. There are 7 characters on both. But it's like, what I liked about it is, it's, they all had their own separate paths, and they all had their own RPGs. Like, each character could
all
give...
All of them had their own stuff.
No, what I mean, like, it was they had their own starting off story. Like, you would start off... Yeah. And...
Yeah. Make it better?
I mean...
Does that make Sensei Densetsu? I can't even say it right now.
Second to Densetsu 3?
Second
to Densetsu. Well, actually, thank you. That's actually...
Does that make that better than Chrono Trigger? Because it doesn't.
Well, actually, hold up. Now we're getting into subjective talk. We're getting into subjective talk right here. Listen.
I don't think it does.
Second Densetsu 3 or Secret of Mana 2 or Trials of Mana, for those of you who don't know the previous two, I'm saying Trials of Mana is better than Chrono Trigger, which is both, they were both from the Super NES. Yeah. Interview's over?
Y'all have a good night. As a person who's played that game. Y'all have a good night.
You played Trials of Mana.
My man Avedon obviously chose to start his 2020 off by smoking crack. And I wouldn't advise it, because I'm from the home of Murray and Barry. And we don't endorse that.
First of all, like, for me personally, I enjoyed Chrono Trigger, but Sega Densetsu 3 just hit differently for me. But I can understand why people like Chrono Trigger more.
I'm not saying that you can't like it more. I'm saying, if we're talking all around everything,
well,
graphics, story, how well everybody's parts in the game come together and match, the multiple endings, new game plus, all of it, the gameplay, the battle system.
That's all subjective, though, at the end of the day. It's more.
It's all subjective, but it's subjective when it all comes together. Packaged better. Is it really packaged better? Chrono Trigger. I think Chrono Trigger is the closest thing to perfect you can ever find in packaging a video game.
Fair enough.
I mean, that's why the dream.
Listen, you know what we're gonna do? We're gonna let the chat decide. We're gonna let people in the comments down below. If you've been watching for this long, I want you guys to go in the comments down below and say definitely tweet us, man.
Bring it live and down at me. At me, Slim. Like, real live.
Let us know if you like Chrono Trigger better than
Don't at me if you're just gonna hit me up and say you can't even say Seiken Densetsu 3. It's 1:42 a.m. Okay. I don't wanna hear nothing.
See. It's called Beats for Breakfast. You're letting them know.
People have breakfast at 1:42 a.m. We from the hood.
Yeah, we do.
We feel 24/7. It don't matter.
Yeah, breakfast. You know. Speaking of which, I should hit up Denny's or IHOP. No, I got Thanksgiving.
Now y'all are seeing the real Abadon. For anybody that doesn't know what happens after the chill cast, the first thing he does every time is get something.
Always.
Every single time. Listen, I've known this for a year now, and he has not stopped this trend from going.
Listen.
He has a hell of a streak going.
Talking requires energy.
Hey,
so I need to refill my energy and get some food in my system.
That's his story, and he's sticking to it.
Hey, I am. And you know exactly what's going to happen after this podcast is over. I'm getting me something to eat.
Yeah, nah, I hear you, man.
But we're gonna close out with more of a serious tip. You know, we've been kind of like lighthearted all night, and we alluded to it earlier. With gamers and everything, the types of gamers that are in the sphere of YouTube, either Twitch or even Mixer. You have people who just take gaming a little bit more differently these days. Mm-hmm. Gaming is different. It's not the same as it was growing up. It's not just a small pastime. Is not something that you just talk about with your friends at school, but gaming is a real entertainment and a live event now. It's something that people could get paid hundreds of thousands of dollars to do if they compete and win.
Right. So, or just talking about it.
Exactly. Or just talking about it. There's people who just talk about it. They make YouTube content channels and they're getting paid four to five figures a month to talk about.
Some six,
depending on their company. I say 4 to 5 for the people who are more so solo. I haven't heard of anyone who's doing 6 and they're a single entity. I feel like
somebody like a MatPat is definitely making 6.
Oh, definitely making 6 easily.
Yeah,
easily. But I would say it's like he definitely has a team of people he could pay. He could employ, and that's crazy. We're in a place of gaming where you could actually employ people to work for you. That is mind blowing.
Yeah.
But just off YouTube. It's not including merch. This is not including other streams of revenue. But
the Completionist does that. Yep.
Yeah.
Him also. He has a whole squad of employees in an office making these videos. Crazy.
Exactly. I wanted to give you room to go ahead and just because if you. People watch the Chillcast, you actually gave some really good advice on being a brand you did earlier in this interview. How can gamers use their platforms to promote more so positive change and even positive development amongst each other?
That's the first really complex question of the night.
Yeah.
Because the fact of the matter is that has to be someone that you actually are.
Exactly.
You actually have to be a positive person to push that.
Yeah.
And consistent with it. I mean, you can have somebody trying to do the whole positive thing because they know it's a good image for them, but eventually they're going to slip up and show that they're not that. Mm-hmm. I think I do a balanced job of giving the positive words on my Twitter and things of that nature. And I can do a good job of letting y'all see that I'm just a regular dude who talking about things like video games, music, anime, TV shows, nostalgia, mobile tech, sex, whatever it may be, relationships, love, black struggles, the black condition in America,
mm-hmm.
like social issues, I talk about all of it because that's who I am. Exactly. So I think the best way to use your platform to speak about positivity is make sure you're a real positive person. Make sure that you're actually positive. And then speak your heart. Because that's all I do. All I ever do when y'all see my tweets on there, I'm just speaking my heart. Mm-hmm. If I'm not speaking my heart, I'm speaking my mind. And my mind is definitely guided by my heart. So it's still the same. Like, just be real. And if that's not you, don't pump fake. Because the truth comes out eventually.
They'll get called out too. But
what's done in the dark will always come to the light eventually. 100%. So if you actually toxic and you know one of them evil people, be you. Now, with that being the case, you can't expect nobody to have to pay you attention either, though. Because I am fully in support of the whole blocking and muting people movement when it comes to social media. 100%. I fully support it. I have hundreds upon hundreds of people blocked and muted on Twitter because I don't, why should I have to subject myself to your negativity,
right,
or your trolling or your BS? I don't have to do that. And nobody has to do that. I know, like, they tried to paint this narrative of, oh, if you block somebody or mute them, then that person just won the argument and you're weak. And it's like, no, actually, I have the power because I just shut them up for good.
And people got the wrong idea. People think that you're... I think it's funny because it's funny you said that. I just want to add small. People think that you're not supposed to police your comments and your timeline.
And you totally are.
And you're supposed to because it's a representation of your brand and what you stand for. And if you catch
And the community that you're creating.
Exactly. And if you see it in your community, there are people who think it's okay to be racist towards you. Is people okay to call you out your name and call you out? Listen.
To harass people?
You don't have to do internet.
To be misogynistic?
There you go.
There's so many levels and so many horrible things I've seen in these gaming communities. And, you know, all I do is when I see that, I distance myself from it. If I see somebody getting themselves near it, I warn them and let them know, hey, that may not be the move you want to make. I can't control what you do or tell you where you should go as far as the community you want to be involved in, but this is what's going on over there. I'm not involved in that. I'm chilling over here. And if you're not into that, you probably don't want to go over there deep.
And that's the way to go about it. It's like, you know, Rob and myself, if we peep something, it's like, yo, we give each other a heads up. We tell other people that were close to us, like, yo, keep an eye out, you know, for different things. Because it's like, at the end of the day, it's just video games. I'm just going to keep it above with you guys.
It's just video games.
It's...
Life gets so much realer. I promise you.
Is at a point where it's like, I know many of us use video games as a form of escapism. And everything, and while that's all well and good for the moment, I'm gonna tell you something. Life is gonna still be there when you put the controller down or your hand comes off the mouse and keyboard.
Yeah,
you still gotta deal with life when you wake up in the morning, you got a job to go to, or you still wake up to life and everything. And
somebody you love got killed, somebody you love got locked up, or you realize you ain't gonna have enough to pay all your bills this month,
and
or any of that.
And to add to that, real stuff happens. So it's like, I feel like, you know, what Rob said, it's like you have to be a positive person. And honestly, you had not only that, but what Rob was saying, but didn't outwardly say, but just to spell it out all the way, you got to be real with yourself.
Yeah.
You got to be positive, and you got to be
real. I thought I said it pretty well.
My bad.
Hey, look, man.
You did.
Be real, yeah. Yeah. Like, stop being fake, yeah. Like,
you drew the picture.
That's all I did. I'm not a great drawer, you know what I'm saying?
No, you drew the picture well. I make my
own words. You hear me?
You drew the picture well, dog. I'm
just realizing.
What up?
I know I'm super comfortable in this podcast because, like, my DC accent came all the way out, man. I realized, like, for the past two or three questions, I've just been in super DC mode. Man, look, be real with yourself and be real with the people around you, man.
Yeah.
Being yourself, there's nothing wrong with letting people see who you really are, man. And trust me, people are going to appreciate that more than you putting on a front, a fake machismo, a fake, oh, nah, everything is okay, a fake, I want to start arguments with everybody to cover up my own insecurities. We see through all that. We've seen it. And, like, for real, like, we've seen this. Me and Avadon, like, it's been
all
there.
Day. And
you know what I'm saying?
And it's like, I also want to add to that, because there's a stigma that's out there that you can't be happy, you can't be cool all the time. Yo, kill that noise. If you are a positive person and you are happy 95 to 99% of the time, yo, be that. Yeah. Don't worry. If people call you fake because you're doing that, that's just their insecurities and everything. Don't feed into, like, if in fact you're actually helping people by you staying positive that amount of times and that openly, because real recognize real. And when they see that this is not a front, this is who you really are, then you're going to have more people gravitate towards you, because that's the type of energy more people want to be around.
Exactly, man. Shout out to my man Mo Better. He's a walking example of that. Philanthropist here in the D.C. area, was a battle rapper, all that. And now every year he's working with some of the biggest artists and but not just artists, celebrities, everybody in the industry here in the D.C. area and outside the D.C. area, to give money back to the community. Like, anybody could be like, oh, who's this battle rapping guy? Why would we give him money? But if he's trying to scam us, no, it's proven every year takes that money, he gives it back to the community for real. So it's like, at the end of the day, if you're being yourself, no matter what you think people perceive you as, you can make a positive change. But you got to have that in your heart first. If you ain't real, nobody gonna respect it, period. Because people can feel real and fake. And if you feel fake, ain't nobody gonna respect nothing you do.
100%.
And that's the end of my statement.
Wow. Well, on that note, we're gonna go ahead and ride on out of here, because we went over the time a little bit, but it was cool. It was good, organic conversation. So, Rob Regal, where can they find you at? What you got coming up, man?
Yeah, man, if you need to find me, you already know. Follow me on Mixer, mixer.com/Rob Regal. You can follow me on Twitter, twitter.com/@Rob Regal, or twitter.com/Rob Regal GXE, or @Rob Regal GXE. Same thing with Instagram, @Rob Regal GXE. And of course, you can follow subscribe to my YouTube channel, youtube.com/RobRegalTV. I had made a whole new YouTube channel, but grew that YouTube channel because YouTube is tripping with the COPA stuff. So we're just going to keep it right there on the channel we're on, because who cares now? Who really cares? It's the Wild Wild West, okay? That being said, man, that's how y'all catch up with me, man. I'm on Mixer most of the time, though. That's my main platform for gaming content. I'm streaming over there. Rock with me. We almost at 700 followers right now. We at 654. We try and make 750 by the end of the year. That's the goal. And yeah, man. Catch me coming out your auntie house. Yeah.
Wow.
You know what I'm saying? Y'all be easy, not sleazy. Make sure you underdig on them overlaying on the underlay. Chill squad. Thank you to my bro, Avadon Smith. Yeah, though.
All day, though. So, with that said, if you like this video, hit that like button, hit that subscribe button, and most of all, you make sure you share this with a friend. This is Avadon and Rob Regal, and we are out. Peace!
No.
Living 10 minutes from D.C. The sample is the state, but the county is PG. We get one time for my county and two times for my state. Maryland is my home, it's the reason that I'm great. We wake up to the grind and give it all that it takes. And if you live where I'm from, then you probably relate. I'm from Maryland. Yeah, homie, I'm reppin'. 301, I'm reppin'. Hands up, we reppin'. One time for the mothers that lost kids over street war. Headed down the wrong road, should've took the detour. Took a left at Landover, made a right at Cap Heights. Went straight at Sea Pleasant with niggas with no act right. It's real to Fullsville, peace to the whole creek. Riverdale, give them hell, New Carrollton knows me. I'll be out on 85th, probably at the liquor store. Round there life, it's best to keep your shit locked. Figure four, if it ain't your home, then I'm talking about your car, though. Niggas take your whipping and stunt with it in Largo. Chop it up in Brentwood, next to West Heightsville. With the choppers trying to get weight off like diet pills. PG to MoCo, Charles County to HoCo. Peace to be more, DMV is the home, though. I rap home anytime that you see me. The sample is the state, but my county is PG. One time for my county and two times for my state. Maryland is my home, it's the reason that I'm great. We wait.